Good morning. Please stand with us as we begin singing today together from the hymnal, hymn number 25, Immortal Invisible. Verses 4 through 7. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Galatians 4, 4 through 7.
Words of Hey, doll. I want to welcome you. We've got a pretty full house today. That's exciting. We had a pretty good group yesterday. I think all in all, with the birthday for Jesus, which was packed out, frankly, that's where I kind of wanted to be, was down there because they had lots of food and fun. But up here, we had probably 25, 30 different people. In fact, at times, there were more people than things to do. And so if you look around, you will see that the church is beautifully decorated. Johnny kind of got loose with the lights on the underneath the sound booth there, but that looks pretty. Here was the thing. It was family getting together yesterday. And even when there was more people than things to do, which is unusual, you just saw people talking, visiting in small groups. And what was especially neat, each of us, we have our own groups that we cross paths with a lot. Several people yesterday introduced themselves to me because we see each other, but we've never actually met. Introduced ourselves, visited for a little bit. And that's what getting together with family is all about. It was a wonderful day, and I certainly enjoyed it. I think the others did as well. So, as family, we take a few moments as we begin our service to greet one another. Go up to somebody you haven't spoken to for a while and say good morning. Week of Advent, and we are looking forward to his coming. We're celebrating Christmas. We're looking forward to his coming in the future. Today, we continue our series on spiritual tune-up. This today is week 6, so open up your Bibles. We'll be getting to that in a few moments. And thank you for joining us for all of this Baptist this morning.
It was nice of you. It was nice of you to let him wear your dinosaur Christmas shirt.
You know, I had like
it was nice of you to let him.
Okay, we've all made it our way back to our seats. This is the second week of Advent, and each week we're inviting a different family within our church family to come and to share some words and read some scripture and to light the Advent candles. So,
good morning.
Good morning.
So, I know quite a few of you, but wanted to kind of introduce my family here. I grew up in this church from when I was about 7 years old until I graduated from high school, and then went away to college and met this wonderful woman. And now we're back with our two lovely sons, Liam and Zach, and this is Stacy. So good morning.
Good morning.
On this second week of Advent, we focus on faith. The faith of a young couple chosen by God for a history-changing task. Seldom does God break into the routine of young lives to ask for such total self-denial, such blind agreement to an uncharted course. We stand in awe of Mary and Joseph as they drop all hopes and dreams to listen to the plan of God for their future.
Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 38 tell us, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her, and he said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.' But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end.' And Mary said to the angel, 'How will this be, since I am a virgin?' And the angel answered her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month, and with her who is called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God.' And Mary said, 'Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word.' And the angel departed from her."
If you would bow with me in prayer. God of our lives, we recognize your right to break into our plans and dreams and put us on the course of your own choosing. But you know our hearts and our innermost thoughts and our fear of taking great risks with the only life you have given us. We ask for faith to allow you to include our lives in your larger plan of history. We ask for courage to walk in the way you design. We ask for assurance that your will is our best choice, our greatest fulfillment. In the name of our Savior, who gave all on our behalf, we pray. Amen.
Well, thank you, Pickens family. We appreciate that. I really have been enjoying the Advent thing with having a family do that and incorporating our members and our family into this. This is a wonderful thing. Well, good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome you to church this morning. We're so glad that you're here on this rainy Sunday morning, but it is a wonderful day. We want to thank you for attending today. We're glad that you chose to come and worship with us. If you would start that yellow pad on the outside of the pew, we'd love to have a record of your attendance. And hi, James, how are you, buddy? We'd like to have a record of our attendance, and then you could pass that across so that we know that you were here. You can also hold on to that pad for any responses that you have. It does not have to go into the offering plate. Is as you listen to the message or through the morning time, if you have something that you want to write down on the back, be assured that our staff does read over all of these. And if you have a prayer request or a question or anything on there that you have, that will get read and it will get addressed for you. If you're a first-time guest here this morning, we want to welcome you as well. We're not going to ask you to stand or embarrass yourself in any way. We want to give a gift for you. If you'd stop by the lobby at the close of the service, we have a gift for you that we'd like you to have. Also, in the lobby area, there's a nice big box. It's like a big giant present, but the lid is off. That's because it's not to be unwrapped and taken out of. It's because it's for you to put things into. And that is the Angel Tree box. So if you had taken one of those gifts for the Angel Tree members, that is due right there today. And if you forgot, don't worry about it. You can turn those in to the church office, but please have those in by Wednesday of this week. Choir practice and the Christmas choir is currently going. They will be continuing their weekly practice. That'll be this Tuesday at 7 o'clock for those of you that are involved in that. And the men's breakfast is coming up this Saturday at 8 a.m. So please come and join us for that. It says here that immediately following, they're going to do a trip to Boise for some target practice. Okay, now I'm not sure what they're going to shoot up, shoot at, or shoot with. Okay, but there's going to be some sort of target practice, and I tell you, it's going to be manly. Okay? So let's look forward to that. And then ladies, if it's guys breakfast, it's also ladies mug and muffin time. That's going to be this Saturday at 10 a.m. You're going to come and learn how to make homemade cinnamon rolls. And if you could bring a wrapped ornament, there will be a gift exchange at that time as well. Okay, next Sunday we have a special guest that'll be leading our worship time. Betty Adams and her all-girl band is going to be able to be here to lead worship for us. It's going to be a wonderful time. I had the great opportunity for opening a concert for hers a number of months ago at the Nampa Civic Center, and that place was packed out. It was wonderful. And so we're really lucky to have her as a family member here at Caldwell First Baptist, and so we're just grateful that she would be able to come and do that next time. And then one last thing to make you aware of, we'd like all of you to know that as we're moving into this season of year, this begins our time of annual meetings for those of us that are members of the church conducting the business of the church. And the elders have been working diligently, and we have completed the proposed budget for this next year. Now, we're making an audible announcement about this because we want you to be aware that it's there. It's posted in the coffee room, the library, that's what it's called. It's not a coffee room. Well, it could be. Coffee and books, you know, all that. It's, you know, it's food, right, John? It's a food room. Anyway, that's posted in there. So we will be discussing that at our annual meetings coming up. One towards the end of December, and then another one in January. So we'll be asking you to vote on those. So if you have questions or something about those to entertain, we want you to know that those are posted, and you can begin reviewing that at this time. Thank you so much.
Well, I think our men are going to be coming forward for an offering, Dan. Is that right? I'll be coming forward in just a moment. About this time, the last 3 or 4 weeks, you've been preparing the children to wander downstairs during the offering. But this is the first Sunday of the month. And what we're doing now is the first Sunday of the month, instead of children's church, we're having a children's sermon. And so right after the offering, you're going to see Peggy T. Sort, my wife, come up here. And she's going to be welcoming the children to come up and sit and share a bit of a message this morning. So that's just to make sure we kind of all know the P's and Q's of what's happening this morning, and so some kids aren't wandering downstairs and finding some food and picking out on food or something, but I don't know. Anyway, as the men come forward, would you join me in prayer? Father, we thank you that today, right now, you are here present with us. We are in this building, but the church is all of us who are a part of this local congregation. We are your church, and we are so thankful that today we can come, join together, lift up our songs of worship, we can share our prayers to you, we can express our needs to you, we can hear you speak to us through your word, but also personally as you speak to our hearts through your spirit. Father, we want to express our appreciation, to look forward through Advent, through your coming. We look forward to Christmas, the celebration of your coming in the past, and we thank you for your coming in the present, coming into our lives and our hearts. And we look forward to the day when you will come again and reign over all. Father, I want to give you great thanks. I want to lift up our missionaries. Father, today we think specifically of Alex and Carmen Chavez in Mexico. We also think of Rob and Jody in Southeast Asia. Lord, we lift these folks up to you who have committed their lives and purposes to serve you. And Lord, we just ask that you would continue to meet all of their needs, those we know of, those that we don't. But Father, you care for them and love them, and we just want to lift them up this morning. Father, we ask that you would speak to us today to know your heart. We ask that you would speak to us today, that we might see and understand those steps that would be helpful and valuable and necessary for us to become more and more like you. Father, we've come today to worship you, to listen to you,
to be with you in fellowship. And today we also come to give back to you of the first fruits, give back those a portion of what you have blessed us with, that we can give to your work. And all of these things, Lord, we give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
We can have the kids come forward. Make sure you're sitting somewhere where you can kind of see the Advent wreath, because we're going to talk about that today. Not too close to the candles. Okay. Yeah, sit down one step. There we go. Here we go. I thought that given this time of year, that it would be really good for us to talk a little bit more about our Advent wreath, because we do readings and we talk about different parts of that, but I'm wondering how many of you really know why we light all of these candles and what all of this represents, because it actually has a lot of meaning and what we call symbolism. There's a lot of symbolism. When we see this round wreath, and sometimes it's a wreath and sometimes it's sitting flat and it's round, and it's almost always has evergreens. And it symbolizes a ring that has no beginning or end or eternity. It symbolizes eternity. And so when we think about God, we think about that God is eternal. And we talk about eternal life, living with God in heaven forever. Did you want to sit there? Okay, here we go, Lisa. But then we have all of these different candles, and they have different colors, and they have different meanings as well. So we have purple candles, and when we see purple, we think of royalty. We think of God as our king, and we talk about hope. Careful, guys. Let's not get too close. Here we go. We think about hope, and one of the candles, we think about the peace of God, the peace that we have with God, and then we think about the love of God. that God loved us so much that he sent his son to die for us. And then we have a pink candle. What do you think the pink candle stands for? Anybody have a guess?
A royal king.
Royal king? No, it's pink. It's not purple. What do you think, James?
Purple.
For royalty. Well, actually, Kenna, what do you think? For love? Okay. Actually, the pink candle stands for joy. And we sing a lot of songs about joy. Joy to the world, the Lord has come, because it's a joyous time when we think about Christmas and we think about celebrating that Christ was born. It's a joyous time. So when you see pink, I want you to think joy. Okay? And then we have our white candle down here. And sometimes that candle is called the Christ candle, but it's white because it stands for purity. Yes, it stands for purity. It stands for the purity of God and the fact that he never sinned, but in fact he died for our sins. Okay? That is the day of Christmas. We celebrate that day. That is the day of Christmas, is when we light the Christ candle, either Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. So all of these things help us prepare for Christmas and help us think about the coming, which is what Advent means. We prepare for the coming of Jesus. And so we light these candles every week to think about and prepare for the coming of Jesus' birth. Okay, now I have Mr. Nate down here has something to hand you. So when you go back to your seats, make sure you take one of those with you, okay? All right.
Well, I'm not sure if you noticed or not, but my toolbox returned to my house. And not that we're finished with our spiritual tune-up, but because with all these decorations, I just didn't fit. So, but we've got this week and next week, we're going to continue. Tim Hazelbaker had originally been scheduled for December, but he has like a three-week series in Philippians, and we only had a couple of weeks available. And so Tim will begin speaking on January 1st. Out of Philippians, and I'm looking forward to it. Tim is a great young man, a great heart for the Lord, and a great student of his word, and so that will be coming up soon. So I want to share with you a couple of things that happened to me just this week. I received a couple words of encouragement. One was an email sent to me, and this fellow was just expressed some gratitude to me for something that I honestly was just a moment of thought on my part, but to him it had very special meaning. I just touched his shoulder and he said, "You don't know what that meant to me." And somehow his email just encouraged me and I was extremely thankful. And then one of our grade school children, I was here on Tuesday evening, I walked by and they said something and I turned around, I went over and sat down next to them and they just looked up at me and they said, "I really like your sermons." And I said, "Really, what do you like about them?" And they go, "Well, I just really like them." So I'm not sure what the rest of you think, but to have an elementary child speak up, being 6'5" guy, I kind of put people off just by my presence. But for this little child to speak up and to share something personal like that and find out that they and their sibling both are getting something out of these sermons, I don't know if there's a higher compliment. And so I appreciate those those words of encouragement. And then I had a lady get in my face right after the sermon last week. Literally, she came up here, and if she could have stood up on a couple of steps, I think she would have literally got right here. And I am so thankful. Because something that I said in my message last week was that I'm still wrestling with putting my seatbelt on. And that got her attention. And she came up and she graciously, as she could, chided me and reminded me. And I said, I agree with it. I believe it. But she says, you're not doing it. I says, well, I'm trying. And she says, well, no, you just need to do it. And I recognized what I'm talking about these weeks of spiritual tune-up are things we all know. We all believe. You look at the core passage and the core message. They're things we all know and believe. And one element of it is we have to make a choice to make a change in our life through the tune-up. But part of it is we've just established habits. And those habits aren't easy to break, but we need to. And so I literally, that moment, out of fear, I think, went and I created a post-it note, and it said seat belts, and I slapped it on my dashboard right next to my maintenance required light that is still on. But I know that I've got between 3,000 and 5,000 miles to get that done, so I'm not as concerned. The seat belts I'm much more concerned about. So I don't know where you're at in our messages on a spiritual tune-up. This is week 5. And this is one that God began speaking to me earlier this summer. It's a stage of life thing in some ways. My mother could no longer care for herself and could not live in her home any longer. And so it's that stage where she came and lived with us for a while, and now she's at Autumn Wind, and they certainly take great care for her. But at that stage, it meant that my siblings and I had to take care of her house. And her house, I think, is probably somewhat typical. It's full of a lot of stuff. And for days and days, I dealt with stuff. Every door, every drawer, every cupboard, every room, inside, outside, garage, there was just stuff. And all the decisions of what to do with the stuff. And I know as we went through that process, the comment was made over and over, I do not want to do this to my children. I do not want to leave all this stuff for them to deal with. And it got me thinking a lot about all the stuff and what was I going to do with that, and I'm accumulating a lot of stuff. And in fact, let me just show you some of my stuff. I have, as you can imagine, I have my laptop. But I got that this summer, but I didn't get rid of my other laptop because I might need it sometime. So why would we ever get rid of good stuff? And then when I don't want to hold that in my lap, I got my iPad because sometimes I use my iPhone and I have a lot of stuff. But see, I need it all because this does so much for me, but it's small, and sometimes I need to see things bigger, and so that's what this is for, even though there's nothing that this does that this doesn't do, but I must need them both because I have them all, okay? And at Thanksgiving, my boys were here. Maybe some of you saw them last week, and my daughter, and we went down Saturday night to look at the lights. Somehow it crossed my mind to ask them. I said, how many of you have your own laptops or computers? Yeah. How many of you have iPads? 7 out of 8. How many of you have iPhones? 7 out of 8. The other one has one of those others. Okay? Anyway. And I started thinking about it. I said, how many laptops and iPads and iPhones or Samsung or Androids do we really need? And I went to my house and I started looking at all the stuff at my house. I used to give my daughter a bad time because I would go in the bathroom and I couldn't even count how many bottles were in the bathroom. I mean, how many different shampoos do you need? dry hair, curly hair, straightening hair, refurbished hair, I don't know what it all, just all these. And then that was just for the hair to wash it. And then there's a whole another group of bottles to care for it or condition it or fluff it or expand it or make it thinner, I don't know. And that's just for the hair. And then you think of the body and the face, because those cannot use the same soap. They have to have different. And you just have a lot of bottles. And I looked in my bathroom this morning, and I counted 17 bottles on my counter. I can't even count all the bottles and tubes and boxes that are in our medicine cabinet. And I opened up the top drawer of my dresser, and it's where I put a lot of different things, and it's just full. And most of those things I haven't even looked at until, except I go back to when I looked, put them in there originally. And it's just full, and I open doors and cupboards, and they're just full. And I will not talk about my wife and her bottles and her stuff, but let me tell you, I open up my closets, and I've got to get rid of things to have room for the new things, because I've got so many things, and I'm getting more things, but I'm not one to get rid of. And then you go out to the garage. How many times do you go by houses, and you see their garage doors open, and they are so full of stuff, the cars have never entered the garage? We got a lot of stuff, a lot of stuff. And I'm not even going to get into brands and logos and the status of that, except to say when we lived in Trout Lake, a little community way north of Hood River, my boys didn't even think about what brand of jeans they wore. But today, there are certain places they would never stoop to purchasing their jeans from, because we've bought into our culture and the brands and logos, that we have to have the right brand and the right logos for the right status for all of our stuff. Ah. This morning, I opened up my newspaper. Okay? Got your paper this morning? You can read mine after the message. Here is the news, and there's ads in there. This is all the ads. Cajoling, tempting, marketing, expressing that we must have lowest price. Anything they can possibly do to communicate to us, you need our stuff, and buy your new stuff from us. And it's we face it every week. All week long, more and more stuff. So, the Lord started speaking to me about my stuff. And let me share with you a couple of verses. One that comes to mind immediately is Luke chapter 16, verse 13. You guys know this. No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Absolutely true. We know that. We believe that. That's not actually the core of the message God was speaking to me. Rather, let me share another verse with you. Luke chapter 12. Let me find it here. This is in the midst of the parable of the rich fool. And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist of the abundance of stuff." It's right there in the text, stuff. Well, possessions, but that's stuff. And it's basically saying, John, guard against this. It's not the measure of your life, all the stuff that you accumulate and stuff that you pass on that your kids are going to have to deal with. And so I began to wrestle with that a little bit. In the parable of the sowers, the thorns are speaking about worries, about riches, about stuff. And the thorns are those things that take our attention away from where God wants our attention to be. I don't think there's any place in the scripture where God talks about it is good and healthy to get more stuff, and to keep all you have, and count it up. And yet, when I think about how much time and energy and finances is goes into buying more stuff, finding the right stuff, getting the best price on this stuff, accumulating more stuff, giving more stuff. It takes up a lot of my life. And I don't see anywhere in Scripture where that God's saying, this is a good thing, John. That's not where you want to put your time and your energy. Now, this is not just a simple, it's better to give than receive type message. It's not a simple, don't get into materialism, although it touches on that. It's just God saying, John, you're putting a lot of time and energy into something that's not really my priority for you. So, let me share a couple other verses with you. And remember, this is hard work because our culture is totally working against this. Well, let's get into the Word. In Matthew 22, we've already talked about the greatest command, and that is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind. It's love Him wholeheartedly. That was our first tune-up message. But the rest of that verse says to love your neighbor as yourself. And that's a little bit hard for me to quite understand, but I'm kind of wrestling with how that really looks today, this afternoon, tomorrow, the next day. But look with me over at Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go over to John chapter 13. John chapter 13. What's God want us to give our time and energy to? Well, here we have Jesus. This is his last week. He's gathered his disciples. And as he's talking about his last messages to them, one of the things he says to them is found in verse 35. 34 it says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you are also to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. So in contrast to stuff, the commandment is we're to love one another. And that's how others will see us. Our lives are to be different. My life needs a tune-up because my life is to be different. When people see and are around me, my life should be different because rather than talking about stuff and having stuff and giving stuff because it's easier to give stuff than my time and energy, what God's saying is you need to love your neighbor, you need to love one another, and that's more than just money. That's giving of yourself. God gives us a great example. Look back at John chapter 13, verse 1. This whole section here talks about Jesus washing the disciples' feet. It's interesting, as you read down through this, Peter said to him, you'll never wash my feet. Oh, no, 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 no. And God says, or Christ says, but I have to. And he says, oh, then wash all of me. And I can relate to this because I've had a couple of men in my life that I've looked up to and honored and respected. And if they were going to come and humble themselves to wash my feet, I would say no. No, 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 no. Let me wash your feet. Let me wash your car. Let me go over to your house, wash your house. I'll wash everything. Because I look up and admire him that much. And when Jesus humbled himself in this passage, when he did that in front of those men, those disciples, when he took that lowly position to serve them in that way of washing their feet, he's basically saying, none of us are too good to be a servant to someone else. That's the message. That whole passage about washing the disciples' feet was to demonstrate to them, not only can you never say, I'm too good to do that, I'm too busy, I'm too whatever. If I lower myself to wash your feet, you have never have an excuse. But it also demonstrates in the most wonderful way the message of, I'm here to serve you and you and you. And to demonstrate for me as I read back to that and say, John, How are you going to wash your neighbor's feet? How are you going to wash the feet of the people in the congregation, your church family? How are we going to do that to one another? Because that's what he calls us to do. If we're going to love one another, love is an action. It's service. It's giving. So, the neatest thing here is that God cares about me so much that he's willing to get in my face a little bit and say, John, wake up. It's all about giving and loving, not getting and storing up. It's about serving, not stuff. That's the core message. Boil it down. That's what God's saying to me. John, it's more about serving than stuff. And I've given a lot of my time and energy to stuff. But it's not about that. It's about giving and serving. So, for me, it's a big change of my perspective and my attitude. Sometimes that's not easy. But it needs to move from what do I want? What do I need? What do I get? Looking forward to Christmas, what am I going to get? To instead, what do you need? What can I do for you? How can I give? That's the challenge for me, to ask those questions. But see, I'm not necessarily built that way. And I'm certain that our culture does not encourage us in that way, does it? I don't think so. I don't see a whole lot in that newspaper there about giving, loving, getting rather than buying from us at a discount today. That will make you happy. How many times have we had a thing that we have just been so pumped to get, and once we have it and we get it, kind of the luster goes away pretty quick. And now it's just moving on to the next thing that we accumulate. And at my house, I've got a lot of things. I've got a stack of things right here. But they do not give me near the satisfaction of those times when I have given and sent someone else has received and been blessed. See, two or three people blessed me last week. And man, I cannot tell you how valuable that has been to me. Words of encouragement. Maybe one of the greatest gifts we can give each other. Sincere words of encouragement. When I went to Multnomah years ago, I did not know the Old Testament from the New. I was not raised in a Christian home. I did not go to Sunday school as a child except a couple of weeks. I never went to camp, ever, until I was a counselor. And that's a wild story, but that's not part of today. And so this just wasn't part of my early makeup, but as I went off to college and seminary and grew and matured in the Lord, this is an area God's continuing to work with me. And the way he did it was he brought a couple along that I met probably my first week or two of college. Their names are Dick and Sue Stewart. They are still giving. They're working with a group. They're in Spain right now, but he was a fellow, and she was a lady that I played on the basketball gospel team with, and then we crossed paths at seminary, and then for the years before we moved back to Colorado, we lived in the community of Trout Lake. And the thing I always noticed about Dick and Sue was they always had their antennas up. They were always listening for other people's needs. And I cannot count how many times Dick and I, or Sue and I, or Dick and Sue and I, and Peg and some others, would be talking to an individual, and as soon as that conversation was over, Dick would look to me and say, John, can I borrow your pickup? Can you? And I said, well, sure you can. I said, what do you need? Well, Mary just now said she has a freezer she has to get rid of and a new one she has to put in her home, and she needs someone to help them move that. Did you? Right by me. I never heard that. I'm sure I heard it, but it didn't register. And another conversation we had, and said, John, can I borrow your pickup? Sure, what do you need? Can I help? Well, yeah, Mark, that we just talked to, said that someone has given them some wood, and they need wood to get through the winter, and so I need your pickup. Right over my head. I cannot tell you how many times that has happened. It's hard work, and particularly for me, it is hard work to hear and listen for people's needs. There are some, I don't know if that's, it's just something that they've matured in, or it's a gift, or both. But I know all of us have that responsibility, because all of us are challenged by the new commandment to love one another. That's how they'll know, by our love. So we have to be in this whole business of giving, of serving, and not getting as our focus. So let me read a few of the things, of ways that God has challenged us to love one another, let others see. Be at peace with one another. Be devoted to one another. Honor one another. Accept one another. Instruct one another. Greet one another. When you come together to eat, wait for each other. Have equal concern for each other. Carry each other's burdens. Bear with one another. Be kind and compassionate to one another. Forgive one another. Submit to one another. In humility, consider others better than yourself. Forgive, teach, admonish, encourage, spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Pray for each other, live in harmony with each other, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Use whatever gift God's given you to serve others. And in 1 John, several times, love one another. In Galatians 5:13 it says, serve one another in love. There's a lot of ways all of us are admonished to give, to love, to serve one another. So, what's that look like? Well, I've got three things I want to talk about here. This should change our idea of giving a little bit. Now, I must say right now, sidebar, this is a very giving congregation. Next week when you hear our talk about budget and all of that, you're going to sense how much of a giving church this is. But just during this Christmas season, I asked Tita to pull up some numbers. This church donated over 100 Christmas child shoeboxes. It donated 27 Emmanuel's Child Stars, $25 each, no, close to $700. The Angel Tree, 26 gifts, more than ever before, for children. The Loving Family, adoptive family, father, mother, two children, gifts, multiple gifts to each of them, plus gifts to the family. And today we'll talk briefly about Advent Conspiracy. Most churches that I've checked out would maybe take one, maybe two of those projects. We didn't put them out there for all of you to participate in all of them, but this church is a very giving church, and they have supported every one of those and given generously to them. But the challenge for me is to change my idea of giving. Advent Conspiracy, there's a bicycle out here on a table. And if you walked in this morning and thought, your first thought was, wow, how do I win the bicycle? This message today is for you, okay? I promise. If that was your first thought, Advent Conspiracy is all about the idea that giving is either about love or money. It's not about both necessarily. And so if we can disassociate giving from money and recognize that giving is an expression of my love, and that can be expressed in serving you, a word of encouragement, admonishing you, all the different ways that I can give, not just at Christmas, but year-round, all the ways that I give. When you think of Advent Conspiracy that does relate to Christmas, the idea is that you as a family stop and say, we are so caught up into consumerism, our culture, And we do give gifts at Christmas, and I'm not poo-pooing giving gifts, but rather let's not make that the epitome, and certainly not throughout the year. But the Advent conspiracy says that perhaps instead of getting or giving, I might take a portion of what I normally would spend and I give it to a special project. And so the bicycle out there is to literally represent this year's project, and that is to give towards Advent conspiracy to raise money to give pastors bicycles who literally are walking from congregation to congregation on Sundays to share the word. And so I'm not suggesting all of you participate, but it's another opportunity. But the whole idea is it's giving, it's loving, it's expressing. And maybe it's not giving towards a bike here, but maybe it's taking and saying, my neighbor has a need, and we want to go and meet that need, whether that takes money or time or work or whatever it takes, the idea of giving. It also changes the idea of church. And this is where you have to do, each of us have to do a little bit of soul searching. Being a part of this church body, and this is the hard question perhaps, am I a consumer or am I here to serve? When you think of coming to church on Sunday, when you think of being a part of this congregation, do you come on Sunday to see what you can get? The music, the message, what you get from the Sunday school classes? We all do receive, but if your whole purpose is coming to see what you get, I think God's challenging me to say, John, being a part of this congregation is, how can I give? And it has to be a conscious thing. It has to be work on our part to stop and ask those good questions. So my question for us is, how are you doing? How are you doing with that? All of these messages are simple, core, basic truths of our walk with Christ. And we have to ask, not do I believe it or should I do it? Absolutely. The question is, how am I doing? And do I need a little bit of a tune-up or do I need a major overhaul? It also changes my thoughts of my neighbors and the people around me. I need to be much more conscious. One, just to meet them and know them. How can I really love them if I don't even know who they are? And neighbors may not be my physical neighbors, but I'm sure it includes that. But it's people in my community, people that God brings across my path. Those are my neighbors. And God's saying, you need to love them. That's the challenge for us, is we need to love them as Christ loved us. So, I'm so thankful that God cares about me so much that he puts this in front of me. He admonishes and challenges me with this message. It's not necessarily an easy message for me. I'm one of those type of guys who just likes to get. And I won't say the word hoard, but I like my stuff. I wish I was a little bit more like my brother-in-law, Carl. He is a guy that if I haven't used it, I'm getting rid of it. I'm not quite that way. I like my stuff. But God's saying, John, you don't have to live that way. In fact, when you adopt give, not get, serve, not stuff, that's how you're going to become more and more like me. And in my deepest heart, I want to be like Christ. So this week, I have to sit down and take some inventory, not inventory of my stuff, but inventory of my attitudes towards my stuff. And think about, am I giving? And how can I give? Those are the questions that I have to ask. It's hard because our whole culture is focused about getting, being first, winning. How much am I going to have or get? And Christ is all about, they'll know your mind because of your love for one another. You're called to serve, to give. So that's the question each of us have to ask. How can I do that? The reminder of is, excuse me. I began this message today by sharing with you words of encouragement that I received. Those people understand a little bit about giving because they gave to me. One of them came up and talked to me and challenged me, and is holding me accountable. that's giving to me. Those are the simple ways which God wants us to love one another. So my question for you is, how are you doing? My next question is, how do you want to do? And what are you going to do about it? I so wish that our spiritual tune-up was as easy as the tune-up for my car. I go down, I pay the guy some money, he plugs it in, he figures out what's wrong, he fixes it, I pay a little bit of money at the end, and it's fixed. But I can't do that with my spiritual tune-up. I got the owner's manual here. I know what to do. But it takes my effort. It's kind of like I'm the mechanic. I have to be the one to fix myself. I'm the one who has to take these admonitions each week in the spiritual tune-up and say, okay, Lord, I understand this is the way you want me to walk. This is the way to become more like Christ. And then I have to take the step. Whether it's changing a habit, whether it's making a choice, maybe it's doing something a little uncomfortable, but it's exactly what God's telling me, John, this is what you need to do. And the result is that deep, deep satisfaction of walking with God in His way. It's the thing that the stuff never satisfies. Amen? Amen. It's all about walking with Him. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you today for your word. Thank you that you're involved in our life and you are not sitting back, and you're involved in my life and you are challenging me to give, to serve, and to express love in an action manner. Lord, free me from my desire for more stuff. Build within me your heart of compassion and concern. Lord, help me to have my antennas up to hear the hurts and needs of others, to listen rather than to speak, and then to act. Lord, this is not necessarily natural for me. It's one of those areas, Lord, where I need you. And so today, in front of all this congregation, I acknowledge to you my need, and I ask you, Lord, to come and give me the strength, give me the attentiveness to live out this truth of serving, of giving and loving. And Lord, for all of us, we want to walk with you. Help each of us. Speak to us. Help us understand that next step to become more and more like Christ. And we will give you all the honor and the glory. And now, Lord, we just thank you as we stop and we come around the communion table. We look to you, Father, to speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we have the opportunity to come around the communion table, I was reminded this last week, Pastor Shaw spent some time in Israel, if you guys were following him on Facebook a little bit, and there was a reminder of this thing called an Ebenezer. An Ebenezer is a standing stone. It's a reminder that God instituted in different places in Scripture. So as the Israelites crossed the Jordan River, they were told to stack up stones there. So as time went by and as their kids went by and they're like, hey, Mom, Dad, what's with the big stones? And it was a reminder to tell them what had happened in the past so that they could come back to who God is and what he does for them. And just the same for us, whenever we get to do communion, it's that opportunity to remember what God has done for us. So as we take some time this morning and as the elements are passed, if you could take some time as you commune with God in your where you're sitting this morning, and just have some reminders of Ebenezers throughout your year. The year's coming to an end here really soon. Just think back. Give God the glory this morning. Think back and give him the praise that he is due his name for the different things this year. Just remember who he is and what he's done for us. in Mark chapter 14. And as they were eating, he took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." As I was sitting here, and my six-year-old, Kenna's asking me, she's like, "What is that?" I was like, "Well, it's grape juice." "Ooh, yum. But what more is it a picture of?" I said, "What color is it?" "Red." "Well, what would that represent for Christ?" "His blood." "And what did his blood do for us?" "Paid for our sins." That's what we're remembering, right? And then the bread, whenever it's broken, did it stay broken? Did his body stay broken? Nope. Came back out of the tomb. This is what we're remembering this morning. Every time we take communion, it's a reminder again of what our Savior has done for us. So let's all take together. Let's take the cup and drink. And next, let's take the bread and partake. And now we're going to lift our voices in praise. If you'd stand with us as the praise team comes up, and we'll finish with a little thank you to God with our voices here. This first song we're going to sing is called "Come to Jesus," and it is just a beautiful picture in words of what it looks like to come to know your Savior.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl, and remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So follow Jesus, follow Jesus, follow Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely, and it's steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance with Jesus, dance with Jesus and live. And with your final the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side, and fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live.
Amen. Ah, it's already December. It's here. Sometimes we can get caught up in the stuff and the craziness of it all. But oh, it's a celebration of who our Savior is. It's the gift that he has given us, that he came to live with mankind so that we know that we can have life eternal with him. Jesus, what a name. Yours will be.
Favor I see, the only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me. The only name that matters to me.
Here we go.
And yours is the
seat. We've got a few things to cover before we go.
It is on. We have another